Yes. Welcome everyone. We only have one mic, so I try to talk as loud as possible so you can hear me. Freek is mic'd up, so welcome to our session. We are coming to compare server 2012 R2 versus XenApp and XenDesktop.
Yep.
For the people who don't know me, I'm Wilco van Bracht. I have my own company, Bracht.net Consultancy. I'm a Microsoft MVP on RDS, Citrix CTP, website, Twitter, and all that kind of stuff.
My name is Freek Bussen. I work for a company called Wortel. Wortel is basically a system integrator that focuses on the Microsoft platform. And within Wortel, I'm primarily responsible for everything related to RDS, TS, VDI, etc. You might know me from my blog, the MicrosoftPlatform.net, and I'm my RDS MVP as well. So before we start, a little naming convention. Obviously, the terminology has changed a lot over the past few years, so to make sure that we're talking about the same terms in this session as well. Looking at the Microsoft side, it all started as terminal services. It was then renamed to remote desktop services in 2008 R2. And in 2012, we got introduced session-based desktop deployment, which basically means doing desktop virtualization based on the RD session host, based on the traditional terminal server model, instead of doing a VM-based deployment where you actually provision Windows 7, Windows 8 VMs. To make things simple, we'll just call it RDS. So when referring to RDS in this session, we're specifically referring to doing desktop virtualization based on the RD session host, based on 2012 R2. So for Citrix?
Yeah.
Go ahead.
We already got some names. I don't call the real ones, the real early ones. Let's start with MetaFrame. And then we got presentation server. Then we got XenApp. Then it became XenDesktop. Then it became XenApp again. Just we call it XenApp. And actually, our users just call it Citrix. And most times, something with a word of it like shit is the most nicest one. But just do it in the presentation, that's called XenApp.
Yeah, so welcome out. We've been talking about what to put on this agenda. Obviously, we cannot do it like a full feature comparison in 45 minutes. So what we decided to do is introduce a new concept, what we call agenda as a service. So basically means you as the audience get to choose what you like to see being covered in the next 40, 45 minutes. So to give this some structure, we come up with these topics. These are the ones we actually prepared in a demo presentation and walkthrough. So who would like to choose the first topic?
Like the client one, one of those clients,
one of the Citrix.
All right.
For 200. Right form. So notice this start screen is actually clickable as well. So looking at the Microsoft side, prior to October 2013, Microsoft has always said, we will deliver a great RDP client for all our Windows-based endpoints. And we'll leave space open for our partners to do the same for non-Windows-based devices. That all changed in October 2013 when Microsoft introduced their own RDP client for iOS, macOS, and Android. Available in the app stores, available for free, which obviously allows them to do a high frequency update to fix bugs, to come up with new releases. And it's also supporting web access. So for example, you could use an iPad, run RD web access on that, click a remote app, and it will actually leverage the RDP client installed from the store. So let's look at some slides on what it looked like from the Windows side. This is actually running on an iPhone. So we signed up for the URL here, which allows us to leverage the remote app WebFeed URL. We log on. We get a list of the remote apps that are assigned to us based on group membership in AD. And I'm able to run multiple remote apps on my iPhone, in this case, with the on-screen touch keyboard. Do a full desktop as well. Obviously, this doesn't make really sense on a small iPhone, but it's the same experience on an iPad as well. So the feature set obviously isn't exactly the same as with the MSTSC client, but it's Microsoft's vision to ultimately allow for the same user experience for all the platforms. That's their primary goal. So that's the Microsoft side. So for Citrix,
Citrix, yeah. Citrix is pretty well known of the huge list of clients available for all kinds of devices, and it still is. I think they have a client for everything. Probably not Xbox, but the other stuff, it's available. But Citrix is still struggling with is the feature set between the clients. That's pretty. The iOS has this, the Android has this, the Windows client, of course, has all those features. So still there's some gaps in between them. And Citrix is really pushing to HTML5 receiver. That would be the new brand thing that can handle all devices. And I didn't have any print screens because we all have seen those demos from Citrix showing a nice Windows desktop on an iPhone or a tablet. So,
all right. So next topic.
I have a question on a previous topic. Is that okay?
On a previous topic?
Yeah, which is? The one you just had. About Windows, the RDP, non-Windows clients. What are the big things that are missing?
There are some things missing around certificates. I have seen some certificates issues specifically on iOS, and I've seen some issues regarding a full single sign-on when actually using WebXS. So, yes, you can use WebXS on an iPad and actually allow that to launch a remote app, but it's not a full SSL experience yet. So, those are some examples of what are currently missing. But in the meantime, since the launch, I think there have been 3 or 4 updates on the client as well. So they're constantly updating and improving those clients.
And the user experience is comparable?
What do you mean with user experience?
Well, compared to the Windows, what do you mean by?
You mean for graphics and stuff like that?
Yeah.
I haven't really tested that high graphics thing, so I wouldn't know. So. Claudio.
Just a couple of things, Michelle, as well. The certificate issue that you mentioned, the funny thing is, you have issues that they work on non-Windows platforms. And I had issues with Windows clients that refused to work at all in 2012 or 2. Microsoft couldn't find where the issue was. So that's a funny thing with the non-Windows clients. They work and, you know, the Win32 one refused to work. The other funny thing is there is no Windows phone client.
Yep.
So
that's true.
It is something for all the other platforms, but not for your own phone. But that's a very funny one as well.
Only MVPs have a Windows phone.
Windows phone is actually coming. They're working on a client for Windows phone as well. So
performance-wise, it's very similar. Like I run on the Mac all the time, and you know I haven't tried really to do like remote effects on 8.1, but overall it works pretty well.
All right. So who wants to choose another topic for us to cover? If nobody chooses, we'll just choose a cover. That's one here.
Emco?
I want to see how shitty both Russian features can
be. That's a great way to announce the feature.
Yeah.
So user profile disk. Who is aware of the user profile disk feature in 2012, 2012 R2? Who is using it actually in production? Two hands, all right. So it's basically a new way to work with the traditional robbing profile that we knew up until this release. What it does is it stores your profile in a single file, a VHDX file, on a central share. And upon logon, it will create a mount point to that file, allowing you to write data to the file as if it were a locally running directory. So it roams within your collection. That means that you cannot roam settings outside of your session collection. So that means that if you're running multiple session collections, for example, if you're running a session collection for full desktop and for remote app, you would not be able to roam those sessions across those collections. So that means that you would end up with a UPD file per user per session collection. So that's something you need to be aware of. Since it appears as a local disk, it improves application compatibility because the application is still writing to C user's username and then the folder it will write to. And also, since 2012 R2, we got support for deduplication, which means I can now leverage the deduplication feature within the file services role in 2012 R2, which result in somewhere between 60 and 90% savings in disk space. So I prepared a little demo to run this. And actually, I deployed this demo running on Windows Azure. So that would mean I have to be able to connect to this environment using this Wi-Fi. So luckily, I actually listened to Alex and created a recording. So we're just going to look that at how that looks. So this is the Server Manager console, and here you can see that I'm opening the 2012 R2 session collection. I open the properties. I select user profile disk, and it allows me to obviously first enable user profile disk. There we go. Enable it, which is actually enabled in the box, under the box, using a default session collection. I can specify the path to store those with a maximum size. And I'm able, in this case, I chose to store all settings available in the profile. Obviously, you can also do exclusions for specific folders, what you want to exclude from your UPD file, or use a only specific folders and leave out the rest. So this is how you configure it on the session collection level. Well, we actually going to browse to the folder where the UPD files are stored. If we double click that folder, yep. You'll see that we'll end up with a template file, which is created when we're initially configuring UPD. And there is a UPD file per user. And somebody within Microsoft thought it was a good idea to name that file after the SID of the user, which makes it really easy to determine whose user profile is his. So when you look at the properties, the security properties of this file, I'm sorry, we're also mounting this file, you can actually see that there, the complete folder structure is there that you usually would see under C user's username. I didn't mean to do that. It's now stored in the UPD file. And actually, if you do mount that file, be sure to also detach it or demount it to make sure the user is able to log on again using that UPD file. So I'm not sure if this is in the demo as well. Actually, we have a little script that reads the UPD share and actually outputs the CSV file, the user that is connected to that disk, to allow you to actually see the user account that is mapped to that virtual disk. And there's also a Citrix tool available for free download, actually has a UI interface to do the same. But obviously, Microsoft should have done this a better way. So that's for the Microsoft side.
Question?
Sure.
When the user fills that up and gets to the 20 gig, what happens?
You get a message.
They actually get a message?
Yeah, that is full.
No, it's full, something like that.
Yeah. Okay,
unlike the stupid PBB that just craters?
It's a little bit better. It's a little bit better. you cannot store anymore, and it's just saying your disk is full or something like that. I don't know if it's still available, but I've done a presentation about user profile disk a few E2Es ago in Hamburg. So we have a session about 40 minutes. Hopefully it's recorded, you can watch it back. And did some nice stuff with Andrew, sizing and desizing, that kind of stuff. So.
Yeah.
Question
about performance of the file server. If you implement this in a large environment, I can imagine a lot of IOPS are being generated on the server or SAN or whatever hosting in the share.
Yep.
Have you had any experience with that?
I have some experience, although it is, of course, running on an SMB3 leveraging 2012 R2, so that should be enough performance to run it, but I don't have any figures or like graphics to show you when it's going to actually stop working or stuff like that. So, but that's a good thing. You should look at that before you start implementing this.
Regarding make a dedupe, a separate dedupe for every user, or it's making a dedupe for all the users. So if there's an Excel file that is, or let's say a brochure that is a 10 users, Okay, is it intelligent that it will store one copy for all the 10 users?
That's actually a separate feature within the dedupe. When you go to the share and you open the properties of the dedupe, you can actually select specifically the VDI dedupe option there, which is intelligent enough to actually read the VCX file. So that's one of the two options you get to choose when you're leveraging the dedupe there. Okay. So Citrix?
On Citrix side, they actually don't have a real answer to the user profile risk. Citrix has user profile management, but that's just user profile management. And Citrix has the personal VDisk, which does actually do the same, but it's only available for the client operating systems, so not for RDS-based deployments. User profile disk can be used on RDS, so more users on more machines. And PVD is actually mounting a VDisk or a VACD file into the client OS. So you can only have Windows 7, Windows 8 with PVD. You can't have it with XenApp on 2012 or 2008. Nevertheless, it's actually pretty the same principle. It's a disk connected and you can both use it for user data and applications. You can install applications on it. That's a little bit different with user profile disk. It's more creating non-persistent disks, persistent desktops with a non-persistent desktop deployment strategy thing. Specific one VM per user, user profile disk data, user installed applications. You can size it, as you can see in the print screen on the left side. It connects drive letters, it's reserving one part for the profile management and another part for the software installations. You can tune that if you want in registry, but it's only for client OSs, and I don't see it much in operational situations. It's nice for proof of concept, but I don't want to do that in production actually. I don't know if anyone is using it in production. PVD? One, two, okay.
Okay, so we're back to our start screen again. So, sorry?
No bouncing.
So from the Microsoft side, load balancing is really the basic load balancing based on least amount of sessions. So it's actually the connection broker that does this job. It allows you to spread users over your separate RDSH service by using a least connection and still allowing you to reconnect to existing sessions. So, and you can disable this as well in GPO, but in this case also the RD connection broker always handles the initial connection. So prior to 2012, you could get a situation where your initial connection was actually being handled by one of the RDSH servers within your farm. That connection, that session host would then connect to the connection broker to ask for, is this a user that is trying to reconnect to an existing session, or can it stay on my session host? In 2012, you're always connecting your initial connection towards the connection broker. The connection broker holds a database. We make that RD connection broker available in HA or prepared for HA. The database is actually stored on a separate SQL server instead of on the connection broker itself. And using that session table, it allows you to reconnect and distribute your sessions across your RDSH servers as part of your session collection. So it's really basic load balancing based on least amount of sessions. If you want to do more, you obviously need third-party tools to actually start using a virtual load and start looking at CPU, memory, disk I/O, stuff like that. But this is what you get out of the box. For Citrix?
Citrix is well known of the wonderful load balancing techniques for a long, long time. Microsoft is catching up a little bit with amount of users load balancing stuff. That's pretty okay. But if you are taking a look at what we've got in the previous versions, XenApp 6.5 and the XenDesktop XenApp 7.x, we are losing a lot of evaluators. This is 7.5 and 6. Just looking very hard. These are all the counters are less load evaluators. The question is that a bad thing actually, because does anyone actually load balance on pages per second, context switches, and all kinds of cool stuff. We had more page swaps, page faults. This. So they are going back to more basic load elevators, which we probably are really usable. CPU, disk usage, memory usage, that kind of stuff. The only thing that I'm really missing is the scheduling possibility, the time stuff that I often use to get a server out of the farm without any issues connecting with RDP and that kind of stuff. That's one is still missing. I hope that one is returning sometimes. But yeah, there can be a feature gap if you are really using that one, but I don't think anyone is actually doing that.
Alright.
Yeah.
So we're back here. Does nobody want to see the Azure Remote app? You do? It's actually new.
Yes, new.
So, Azure Remote App. Who has heard about Azure Remote App? Who has signed up for the free preview and has actually started using it? Okay. Couple of people. Cool. So, Azure Remote App is actually publishing remote apps using Windows Azure. Obviously, you could have done that before by creating your own RDSH deployment on the IaaS, on the infrastructure as a service platform on Azure, where you basically deploy your own remote apps. But this is different. This is really publishing a remote app as a service, so on a subscription level per user per month. It comes into two different deployments, a cloud deployment and a hybrid deployment. Cloud deployment is really the basic deployment where Microsoft itself is actually in control of your RDSH template. And with the hybrid deployment, you have more options to also connect to your on-premises environment. We'll dive a little bit deeper into that later on. And it's currently into free preview. So some of you have signed up for it. It's a free preview you can sign up for. It has to be obviously approved, so it can take a little while. I've had some complaints about people that it actually takes a bit longer to get an approval for the sign up. But it's there for free to try out for at least 20 sessions and two app collections. So we'll look at two different deployments, and these diagrams are actually taken from the original announcement made on Tech at North America. This is the cloud deployment, which basically means, as I said, Microsoft is in control of the RDSH template, so that means that you do not have admin permissions on that box, and Microsoft is able to elastically grow and shrink the RDSH farm to make sure that there are enough RDSH servers available for the current amount of users. So basically what you do is you select the cloud deployment and Microsoft starts provisioning a RDSH farm with some pre-apps installed, which actually contains the full Office Professional Plus suite, including Visual, including Project, and you're able to publish those remote apps using the existing Azure portal, as we'll see in the demo later on. And your end users can use basically any device, not all devices yet, to authenticate using either a Microsoft account, so your existing Outlook.com, Live.com accounts, or use a Active Directory account, which is dir-synced with your on-premises ID, leveraging Azure Active Directory. And all users get a persistent user disk, which is 50 gigabytes, which is actually based on the user profile disk as well. So this is the cloud deployment. And you can actually get this up and running within 5 clicks. So it's really easy to get this up and running. For the hybrid deployment, you as an admin are actually in control of the RDSH image. So basically what you do is you create an RDS image on premises, you install your LOB applications, you install the RDSH role, you install desktop experiences, desktop experience feature, you sysprep it, and then you upload it to Azure. And as soon as you upload it, Azure will start using that image to deploy your farm. So in this case, Microsoft does not own your RDSH template. The only thing they do is elastically grow and shrink your farm as users start logging on. So in this case, since you are controlling the RDSH template, you can also join it to your local domain using Azure VPN. And that means that your end users and your applications are able to access corporate data that is on-premises. So the applications can access file shares, SQL servers, application servers using the Azure VPN. In this case, obviously, you can publish the remote apps as you like. So there are no pre-published remote apps here in this case. And you can use authenticate users using the Azure Active Directory. That's the only option for this deployment, so no live accounts here.
So, question, Frank.
Sure.
Was this all not already possible or before the remote app announcement?
What you could do is create your own RDS service within Azure and have that connected with your Azure VPN, although you wouldn't have the elastic runtime where they automatically grow and shrink the farm as users start logging on. So that's one of the new features here. And obviously you can still use the Azure portal. That's obviously also different in the scenario you're describing. You can use the Azure portal to publish remote apps. So let's do a demo. Again, it's video, I'm sorry. So this is the Azure portal that I just logged onto. And what you'll see is there is a new option here available, which is called Remote App, obviously. I'm going to click that option. You can see that I already signed up for a Remote App collection, which is called Burson Apps. It's currently active, and you'll see the link for clients to download the client. We open up that collection. You'll see that currently no sessions are logged on, so 0%. And here you can see the user that has access to this deployment. In this case, it's a cloud deployment, so I signed my personal live account to be able to log on. And these are the remote apps that are actually available out of the box. So you get the full Office suite, Internet Explorer as well, and I also added the CMD here, which is not there by default, to do some additional testing later on. And here you have an overview of the sessions. Currently no sessions are available, but if there were, you'll be able to log them off, disconnect them, or send them a message just as the on-premises. This is the new client that you actually need to install. You cannot use the same MSDSC client. It is a free download for some of the platforms, iOS, Windows, and more platforms like that. I log on with my live account here. And when I do that, it will actually start updating the client to start using the webfeed URL to retrieve the remote apps that are assigned to me using the Azure portal, as you can see here. And you are able to launch these remote apps using a single sign-on to be able to start using them. You can also sign up for multiple workspaces as well. In this case, it's just one. So you'll be able to leverage multiple workspaces within one client. Now, when I start one of these remote apps, and you actually have to double-click this, so that might be the first time as well. You have to double-click it. It will start launching. It will create a logon on the RDS server that's currently running. Obviously, the first logon will take a little bit longer because it has to log in as well. As we'll see later on, secondary logons will log in much faster because they're using the same session for that user that is already active. So in this case, I'm launching Word as a remote app. There we go. So this is Azure remote app running on my client. Now, as you can see, we're using RDP 8.1 because the contents of the remote app are available when I move it around. And also I have live taskbar preview of this remote app available, indicating that it's RDP 8.1 2012 R2. In this case, I open the command line to do some more testing on what exactly the host is. I open Excel to show that it's the speed of the logon is much faster. In this case, I'm opening computer management, what it actually allows me to do. And what I see here is that these are the usernames that are on this box. There's my live account there. But there's also a RDS admin. And the RDS admin is obviously the account that Microsoft is using to publish this RDS 8 server. We do not have the password for this account, of course. But that's the one that's being used. When you open up Explorer, and you go to the properties of my computer there. This is the C drive, actually, and here you can see that the user profile is mounted using my live account, the 50 gig. And I think we're going to now open the properties of this computer, and here we'll actually see that it is running 2012 R2, and it has a 2.1 gigahertz, 3.1 gigabyte memory, and there's the host name of the computer, which is obviously automatically generated as they are elastically growing and expanding. Also notice this is running in a workgroup, so there's no domain join here, so this is actually a RDSH role-based installation. When we browse through a local drive, this is the local drive of my laptop, you'll notice that the folder is there, C user username, app data, roaming, RD client, RADC, and in there, there's a GUID, there's a resource folder, and these are the remote apps that are actually published to my account. Notice that they took off the .rdp extension, which obviously does not stop me from editing it with Notepad, for example. So this is actually the contents of the RDP file. And notice there is a funny comment there, do not change or remove anything above these properties unless absolutely needed. So that's funny. It's actually using a new gateway credential method, number 6, which is new in the RDP properties. I'm guessing here that's probably because I'm logging on my live account. Also notice that I'm using a gateway server here, which is, according to Microsoft, I've been asking around this. This is not a regular RD gateway, but it's a equivalent of the RD gateway, but it wouldn't give me any more details on that. And when you actually run a regedit on that box, you'll see that, in fact, there is a RDSH role-based installation being performed, and these are the remote apps that are being published on that box. So it's the same as with an IIS solution where you'd install a RDSH role-based installation. All right. I'm sorry?
Is there any features not supported in Azure that are working on
that? Not that I'm aware of, no. It's just regular RDP, but you're obviously forced to use the RDP client that comes with the Azure environment. So that, but underneath is actually running the MSTSC to do the RDP file, so I'm assuming it's just RDP 8.1, just as an on-premises environment. Any questions about remote app? Well, you would have to start managing your own image, obviously, and doing it on premises. And as you install new LLB applications, or if you want to change stuff on the RDSH, you have to upload that image again and start reusing it.
What's the method for uploading that? Is it HTTP or is it?
Good question. I actually don't know. I don't know. Sorry. Good option. Okay. So to get it quick.
Frank, there's one thing you should mention that you need to sys prep the image before you upload it.
I didn't mention that. I'm sorry. Yeah, you need to sys prep it. Yeah.
And the reason why you need to sys prep it is they are able to distribute it among multiple physical machines. So they spin up new VMs as soon as you are using a certain amount of load. And this is why the image has to be sysprep. This is why you may see different names of the VM when looking at the name from different user accounts. So this is something that I didn't have in my mind when I started doing that. But then they said this is why you need to sysprep it.
Yep.
Because they can spin up like dozens of the same machine just to distribute the load.
Good, thanks. So this is the feature overview of the solution. As I said, we're in a free preview for you to sign up with. 2012 R2 using RDP 8.1 has Office Professional Plus on it. I think Adobe as well to use PDF stuff. The device platforms are currently Windows 7, 8, iOS, and Android. Coming soon, again, Windows Phone. Windows Phone is always coming soon. Windows RT and Mac OS. We have support for live account, support for federated account using Azure AD. The 50 gigabyte, and currently you can do 20 users per account. And actually that's, I think, limited to 10 users per app collection. So you can create two app collections in your preview and allow 10 users per app collection to start using this. And it's available in several regions at the moment. Okay.
Is it also possible to publish a desktop?
No. So it's really bound to using a remote app. I actually have tried to modify one of the RDP files, remove the SSL encryption, and swap that back to a RDP file using a full desktop, but it doesn't work. So it's really focused on using an app structure.
Could you also try launching MSTSC from the command line and connecting to localhost?
Good point. I haven't tried that. I will try that.
Black hole in the infinite loop of nothingness.
Yeah. Well, in fact, you could obviously. Yeah, you could actually publish MSTSC as a remote app and start to it as a local account. Yeah, I'll try it. Thanks. Okay.
Okay.
Citrix.
Citrix side. At Synergy, Citrix announced Citrix Workspaces. Bootix, it's exactly the same as Freek's just showing from the Microsoft remote apps. No hands? Everybody thinks it's completely different or the same or? You all watched the presentation from Synergy for it. Because it's definitely not the same. Definitely not. It's more about management, about what Citrix now calls the controller hosts. I was completely distracted with that option because we are calling the XenApp 6.5 hosts that are hosted, the data collector controller host nowadays. But that's the whole suite of things that's supporting, so the data collector, the web interface, and that kind of stuff. That is what Citrix Workspaces is about. Citrix Workspaces is not about uploading an image which will be deployed by Citrix to the amount of service you needed for your users. That's completely not in the proposition right now, I think. Maybe they're going to move it in that way, but at the moment it's actually the management part, the service hub and controller in this picture. There's not much information available actually. I asked Citrix a lot of stuff. The first question they asked me, why would you like to compare it with remote app on Azure, because it's completely different. Okay, that's step one. So I only have a few screens from presentations. That makes it a little bit clearer. Definitely was SYN 126, if you want to know more about it. They are trying to explain what Citrix Workspaces is in this session. There's a technical guy, that's the guy at the right side, and there's a marketing guy involved, and that's the other one. And that makes the story a little bit difficult because he's talking about providing desktops and that kind of stuff, and when the technical guy is talking over, he's just showing, okay, we are putting off your data collector, your web interface into our Citrix Workspaces container, and you are still responsible for managing the XenApp session host, the XenDesktop clients, that kind of stuff. So it's completely different. You can subscribe for the preview. Preview is expected in second half of 2014. So it can be 31 December, I don't know. And yeah, that's actually what's available. So a small demo in the keynote and the session which only was technical and PowerPoint. It didn't show anything else there. So I saw 5 minutes sign a few minutes ago, so probably we are almost out of time.
Okay.
So if there are any other questions, then 12 million.
So, the last one.
I know if you have time for it, but...
Can we? Yeah. I'll just quickly do the shadowing then, I guess. Just easy to do. So shadowing has obviously been around for quite some time. I know a lot of people are using it for help desk purposes and stuff like that. It was actually removed from Server 2012. So we got a lot of feedback, negative feedback, on why the hell they removed that. And they started to reintroduce that in 2012 R2. So it's now available again. But it's now actually part of the MSTSC client. So what you can now do is MSTSC / shadow / ID. And you can actually start using the shadow option there. It's also available from the GUI, so using the RDMS, the Remote Desktop Management Services, you can right-click a user and say shadow, that still works. And new is in this, using 2012 R2, is the support for remote apps. So you can now shadow a user that's running remote apps. Previously, you could not do that. Well, technically you could, but you could get really weird stuff going on. So you can now actually do remote apps shadowing.
Craig, is it exactly the same implementation as in 2008 R2?
It's not.
Is it still the issues with multiple screens and I'm on one screen or your setup?
It should have less issues. Let's keep to that. So we'll use a little quick demo of what that looks like from an admin and user side. What I'll first do is add some or launch some remote apps. This is the environment that's running on Azure as well. So in this case, I'm opening up a few remote apps to start showing that session. In this case, calculator. I think it opens another one, which is paint. And then if you look at the MSTSC properties, or actually the help file there, you load that as an new option slash shadow, which is used to start the shadowing. So obviously I still need the user ID. So in this case I'm using a PowerShell command to retrieve the user ID, of the session ID of this user account. And in this case there's only one user logged on, so it probably is session 2, which it is. And then I use the command MSTSC, and in this case I'm specifically entering the server name slash shadow, and then I get the prompt of the user account. In this case I'm choosing no, because also I'm showing the GUI here. So this is the RDMS GUI again. We refresh so you can have the new users. We click shadow. Oops, shadow. And it will ask, do you want to view or do you want to control this session? We choose control. And what happens here, obviously you get the message again here. What happens is a black square is painted, and that square is actually representing the end user's desktop. So in this case, I'm shadowing remote apps. So the remote apps should be coming up now. And as you can see, the black border is in fact representing the desktop of the user. And I can now start interacting with this user. It's a bit lagging. I don't know why that is in this demo. But this is how it works. So obviously you get the same with using a full desktop. It'll be practically the same as this one, but it'll then be projecting the full desktop. I think that's it.
But you still need two information. You need the username and the server is on.
If you're on the server, if you're on the server name, you can leave out the server name, but you still need the user ID to actually connect to that ID. So there's multiple ways to get it, but PowerShell seemed like the most easy one to do that. Or use the GUI, and you don't have to specify anything. Okay. Well, we've gotten through this. So Citrix.
Yeah. I see we are almost out of time, so now we left the demo. Citrix is actually relying on Microsoft for the remote control part. So when Microsoft removed our shadowing stuff, it was also gone in Citrix. Then you have the remote assistance feature. I checked on 7.5, which in 2012 R2, hopefully because Microsoft introduced the shadowing back, but it's still only for remote assistance. And you can start it out of the director console, and then it's actually the same as Microsoft. So.
All right. So I guess we're running out of time now. So, well, thank you for your time, and enjoy the conference.